Amen. And so today, I wasn't supposed to be here, but that's okay. I had military duty scheduled, but they had a change of plans, and so they rescheduled me, and so I'm here this morning. You know, Pastor Teresa goes, okay, since you're here this morning, you talk about sex. Am I up, Rich? Okay, thanks. So we're going to be talking about sex. More so the intimacy, as you can see, it's entitled Into Me See. Everybody say, Into Me See. So what does that mean? Okay. Bottom line up front is that we're going to talk about how sex sometimes is a very, it's very misunderstood. You know, and people look at it from different perspectives. People kind of get squeamish when we talk about sex, right? Especially here in church, right? We shouldn't talk about sex in church, right? But, you know, we want to dispel all that, you know, all those myths, you know, that that the world seems to define for us. And that really makes me angry, you know, if you will. Because, you know, something good that God created, right? And then the world just kind of perverts it. So we're going to talk about what perversion means. We're going to talk about how God defines sex and how we can celebrate sex. And really, it's not anything to be ashamed of. You know, it's not, and I understand. And I want to be sensitive to that, brothers and sisters, where, you know, people are, again, like I said, squeamish about the subject, or people tend to be a little bit more modest than some. But we're going to talk about these things and hopefully, like I said, dispel the myths that surround sex, okay? So again, we're going to be talking explicitly, everybody say explicitly, talk on sex, okay? But just to review a couple of, about a month ago, Mother's Day, right? For the explicit series, Pastor Teresa launched the whole series along with our kids. So if you remember, they were all lined up over here. And so we were talking about Mother's Day. So an explicit look into the life of parenting, but from a mother's point of view, because it was Mother's Day. So that was an explicit look into the life of the Rosario family, right? I mean, not that we're all that or anything like that, but... It was an interesting perspective because I didn't exactly know what was going to come out of my children's mouths. It's kind of a risk we take, amen? But, you know, we encourage them to be very open, very honest, very explicit about how they're feeling inside, right? And so they're very good at that. And so we appreciate that about them, you know, being open and honest. And I remember a couple of weeks ago, I was kind of hanging out with Misha, and Misha was on YouTube. And she was kind of looking at these different vlogs. Are you guys familiar with vlogs? Video logs, like blogs, vlogs. So she was looking at those, and then she was kind of like, you know, following, you know, some of these girls, or some of these females from around the world. And I said, what are you watching? What is that, right? And so she said, well, it's a vlog, Dad. You know, kind of get into the 21st century. So she was explained to me what that was, and basically it's kind of like a reality show snippet, if you will, where people go on YouTube, they videotape themselves, and it's kind of like a day in the life of, okay? So I was looking at that, and I really found it fascinating, you know, because people actually do this, and then people kind of garner as many followers as they can, right, from all around the world. And then the whole thing about YouTube is if you get like paid, you know, if you get like over a million hits or something like that, YouTube begins to pay you. So people actually create a living out of doing these kinds of things. So it's pretty fascinating. So I said, Misha, why don't you do something like that, right? Again, you know, not that, you know, the Rosario family is all that, but what I'm saying is definitely we're not boring. There's always something going on in our house. Anyway, so that's just an example of living explicitly, right? Before the Lord, before the world, so on and so forth. As the Lord calls us to be transparent, right? First and foremost with Him, and also as the Word says, as we open up to one another. You know, find people that we can confide in, find people that we can trust and confide in one another. That's what it means to live explicitly, right? And then the week after that, we had Pastor Mike and Mona. You guys remember that? And they came over and they spoke on marriage, right? Pastor Mike has been a wonderful, wonderful mentor of ours since 2001. And we've certainly, you know, grew a lot under his tutelage, you know, both Teresa and I. And it's just been wonderful ministering with him. You know, we had a lot of ups and downs, sure, you know, but of course they spoke explicitly, you know, about their marriage and some of the things that Mona is going through, especially with the testimony of her brother's family out in Maui, right? And then after that, I talked about this, which was last week, about an explicit look into the life of a military family. How many of you guys enjoyed that? It was a little difficult, sure. But then again, you know, as I approached my colleagues, you know, Lieutenant Colonel Mueller and Major Guadiz, I didn't know what they were going to speak about. I just kind of prompted them on what to say, and then the Holy Spirit just kind of took over. And again, they were very open, they were very honest, they were very explicit about what they went through and what they go through and some of the things that the soldiers go through. And it's very important for us to understand because they live within our communities. Amen. And so that was last week. This week we're going to be talking about sex. So the definition of explicit: clearly and in detail, leaving no room for confusion or doubt. I'm just going to go back here and grab my notes. Right? Definition of explicit is clearly and in detail, leaving no room for confusion or doubt. You guys remember this guy? Great, great singer. He had an awesome, awesome voice. And I remember when I was young, right, I heard this song, right? When I get that feeling, I want sexual healing. You guys remember that song, right? Okay. So why are we talking about this song in church, Pastor Glenn? Come on, right? I mean, when I was young, brothers and sisters, I was listening to this song, and this guy had an awesome voice. I would just listen to him. Yeah, I like Marvin Gaye. And then I realized as I got older what he was singing about. Because, you know, when I was like scratching my head, what does he mean, sexual healing? You know, is he sick or something? What's going on, right? Sexual healing. Okay, so I'm going to read a little bit. Okay, let's read it together. Just so we can kind of get an idea and kind of set the tone for today's topic. Okay, so it says, "Ooh, baby, I'm hot just like an oven. I need some loving. And baby, I can't hold it much longer. It's getting stronger and stronger. And when I get that feeling, I want sexual healing. Sexual healing, oh baby, makes me feel so fine," right? "Helps to relieve my mind. Sexual healing, baby, is good for me. Sexual healing is something that's good for me. Whenever," this is pretty good. I mean, it's very poetic, all the images. I mean, really. But we're going to see later on, and the reason why I bring this up, brothers and sisters, is because later on we're going to see the same thing in Scripture of all places, right? "Whenever blue teardrops are falling and my emotional stability is leaving me, there is something I can do. I can get on the telephone and call you up, baby. And honey, I know you'll be there to relieve me. The love you give to me will free me. If you don't know the thing you're dealing, oh, I can tell you, darling, that it's sexual healing." Amen. Now, how many of you, I mean, of course we laugh at that, right? We laugh at that, but how many of you, just by a show of hands, can say there's some truth to that stuff? There is truth to that. Especially the guys. I mean, there is truth to that. I mean, let's not deny it, okay? Let's just call it for what it is. Explicit, right? He's very frank about what he's talking about. He's very descriptive about what he's talking about, you know, apart from, you know, going rated X or whatever. Anyway, let's take a look at another song. How many of you guys remember this one? Right? Let's talk about sex, baby. Let's talk about you and me. Let's talk about all the good things and the bad things. Hallelujah. Amen. But this is good too. You know, let's talk about sex for now to the people at home or in the crowd. It keeps coming up anyhow. This is good. Don't decoy, avoid, or make void the topic, because that ain't gonna stop it. Now, we talk about sex on the radio and video shows. Many will know anything goes. Let's tell it how it is and how it could be, how it was, and of course, how it should be. Those who think it's dirty have a choice. Pick up the needle, press pause, or turn the radio off. Will that stop us, Pep? I doubt it. All right, then. Come on, spin, right? Salt and pepper, right? Spinderella. All that kind of stuff. You guys remember this, right? But how many of you can say there's truth to that? All right. There's truth to that. Now, the reason why I bring this up, brothers and sisters, like I said, it's very descriptive. It's very poetic. It fulfills, how should I say this? The senses, right? It satisfies the senses, the imagery. You know, you talk about fragrance, you talk about touch, you talk about hearing, all this kind of stuff. We're going to see later on again in the Song of Solomon. He's very explicit. The Song of Solomon is very descriptive. Solomon, may I remind you, is the son of King David, right? So he was, of course, he had like thousands of wives and millions of concubines or whatever it was, but you know, he was the son of the man after God's own heart. Okay, so let's, as we talk about this, the point that I want to communicate, brothers and sisters, is that sex is all around us. Can we agree to that? It's in the media, it's in the radio, it's in the TV, it's in the movies, it's in the TV shows, it's in the internet, right? All this kind of stuff. But as we talk about sex, especially when we talk about sex to our children, right? Don't you, as a parent, want to have a voice in it? Right? And not just the media? How's about Bruce Jenner? We won't get into that, but, you know, it's pretty huge right now. You know, if you guys want to learn about that, just go on the news and type in Bruce Jenner and you'll find out what I'm talking about. Those kinds of things influence our culture nowadays. Don't you, again, as a parent, want to have a voice in that? Because God calls us to, amen? That is simply what I'm saying. Paul in Philippians says this, chapter 4, verse 8. Finally, brethren, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is of good repute, if there is any excellence and if anything worthy of praise, dwell on these things. And brothers and sisters, sex is included. Because I'm here to tell you, brothers and sisters, just like our marriage was meant to be stewarded, just like our relationships are meant to be stewarded, just like our homes, our cars, material things, this wonderful church are all meant to be stewarded. Our finances, our exercises, our diet, our food are all meant to be stewarded. Don't you think that sex was meant to be stewarded well as well? Right? That's what Paul was saying about dwell on these things. Things that are good. Amen? God is good. All the time and all the time. And to everybody. Right? And so if God is good and he designed sex, we can therefore conclude that sex is good. Hallelujah, amen and amen. Definition of intimacy. You can write in your notes there, you can squeeze it in. Close familiarity or friendship. Close familiarity or friendship. So nowhere in the definition of intimacy does it say you have to have physical contact. Okay? Close familiarity or friendship. And you know, I love the scriptures. I love Jesus when he exemplifies intimacy, especially with his disciples, right? He talks about intimacy, or he exemplifies intimacy with Mary and Martha, intimacy with Lazarus, you know, his close friends in the New Testament. Amen. Close familiarity or friendship or a closeness. Here we see in Genesis chapter 4. Genesis chapter 4, let's read it together. Ready, go. Adam was intimate with his wife Eve, and she conceived and gave birth to Cain. She said, I have had a male child with the Lord's help. Okay, that word intimate, everybody say intimate. In the Old Testament, and by the way, can we also give Jeff a round of applause for doing, I just want to thank you, Jeff. You know, he came up to me and we knew that he was going to be doing the communion for us this morning. And then he approached me, then he read the Hebrew, Lashon HaKodesh, the holy tongue, right? And it blessed me because I love hearing the Hebrew, because we know that the Lashon HaKodesh, or the holy tongue, really brings us, I believe, more intimately with God. As we speak the language of the Christian forefathers. Amen. But anyway, thank you, Jeff. Adam was intimate with his wife Eve. That word intimate in the Hebrew, brothers and sisters, is yada. Everybody say yada. Now, the interesting thing about yada is that it doesn't mean, well, let me take it back. Yada means more so to know. So if I'm here and you read in the New Testament, I mean the Old Testament, you know, depending on what version you have, it says that Adam knew his wife, or Abraham knew Sarah, okay? If you're reading your Bible and you see that, it means to know. Okay, and what essentially that means is that as Adam knew Eve, they had sex. They engaged in lovemaking. Okay, that's of course how she conceived the child. So if I'm here standing before you and I say I know my wife, that means we've engaged in sexual intimacy, right? I mean, that's not hard to figure out. We have 5 kids, right? But that's what it means. It means that, you know, you engage in sexual interaction, sexual relations. There's many, many, many examples in the Old Testament, okay? So yada means to know. Yada, Y-A-D-A means to know. I know it's not in your notes, but you can go ahead and write that in your margins, yeah? Adam, again, was intimate with his wife Eve, and she conceived and gave birth to Cain. She said, I have had a male child with the Lord's help. Now, this is a picture of a prism. Everybody say prism. Not prison, prism. Okay? So a prism is something that, as you look into, I think two things. You can also have a reflection, but you can also have a refraction. And what that means is as the light hits the surface, it bounces off, right? And that's how it creates that rainbow effect, okay? Now, I'm not sure about the details, but you can talk about, you can go ask Rich and Bradley, and they're smart guys. They probably know about that scientific stuff, right? But the idea here is that the prism is when you look deeply into it, okay? You look deeply into it, you begin to see different angles, different dimensions, if you will. So as you go home, brothers and sisters, and if you're a married couple, you know, think about that. Kind of meditate on that a little bit. Stare at your wife, stare at your husband, and kind of look deeply into them, right? And then God is going to show you many, many different dimensions of your spouse, maybe that you haven't seen in a while. Maybe you haven't seen in a long time. But the idea is, and the way God designed it, is that when you're intimate with your spouse, you're going to notice things about your spouse that no one else does. And that's how it should be. Amen. Because as you engage in sexual relations, right, it says in the word that they become one flesh. Okay? So that's not too hard to kind of understand that concept when you join and you become one flesh. Does that make sense? So go ahead and write your note in your notes. Into me see. Into me see. So think of your spouse as a prism, multifaceted like a diamond, right? And when the light hits you, hits it, right? You get wonderful reflection of yourself because you reflect God. God sees you, you know, you reflect Jesus Christ, but also you begin to emanate different colors and different dimensions about yourself and about that person. Amen. Into me see. Let's talk about what intimacy is not. Intimacy is not objectifying of any person. It is not objectifying of any person. And of course, you know, we can understand this, you know, when we talk about pornography, different things like that. And I remember, I'll share this story. Makes me a little uncomfortable. But I was of a different mindset back then. Okay? When I was in middle school, all right? When I was in middle school, of course, the guys that I hung out with, you know, we all thought the same, all right? There was this one girl in school, and can I just say that her physical appearance was very impressive, okay? And I remember, you know, we were just kind of hanging around, you know, the schoolyard one day, and then she walked by, and of course, all my friends, they kind of went wild, they went crazy, and they started talking about this, you know, this one female in a certain way. And I was listening to this kind of stuff, and I kind of chimed in a little bit and all this. I'm ashamed to say, but I'm being honest, right? She had a very impressive physical appearance, right? And so when I thought about that, I was like, oh, Lord, you know, were we objectifying that person? Of course, I didn't know back then, now that I realize what we were doing. But that's an example of objectifying a person, looking at a person for just her physicality and not looking at her as a human being, as a soul, as a daughter of God. Amen? So you see that difference, objectifying a person. Intimacy is not casual. Intimacy is not casual. In fact, it's very intentional. Okay? When I'm intimate with my wife, notice I say intimate with my wife, we're not just engaged in the physical act of lovemaking, okay? But we're intimate with each other, where we maybe lie next to each other in bed and we're having the pillow talk. You guys know what I'm talking about? The pillow talk that only spouses do with one another. In the wee early mornings, right? Those kinds of things. It's not casual, but it's very intentional. Intimacy is not solely a physical act. We just talked about that. It is solely not just a physical act. In fact, it's much more, right? Intimacy begins before the physical act, and intimacy continues on after the physical act. Intimacy is not isolated. What do I mean by that? You know, culture kind of dictates that intimacy is divided or separated by different things that we do in life, okay? But intimacy is interactive, like now. It encompasses everything in our life. It's very relational. It speaks to the being relational, okay, with one another. Just like when Jesus was intimate with his disciples. Well, he wasn't physical with them, right? But he was very relational with them. And he confided, they confided in one another. So let's turn to the Song of Solomon, okay? Let's turn to the Song of Solomon. And we're going to see that, again, like I was alluding to, that he was very descriptive. Okay, so let's read this together. Ready, go. Let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth, for your love is more delightful than wine. Pleasing is the fragrance of your perfumes. Your name is like perfume poured out. No wonder the young women love you. Take me away with you. Let us hurry. Let the king bring me into his chambers. Okay? Scholars believe, brothers and sisters, that that phrase, for your love is more delightful than wine, that phrase, for your love, can be translated in the Hebrew to your lovemaking, the act of lovemaking. Okay? So your lovemaking is more delightful than wine. Okay? Talking about fragrance of your perfumes, again, the senses, getting the senses involved. Your name is like a perfume poured out. No wonder the young women love you. Take me away with you. Let us hurry. Let the king bring me into his chambers. Now, what do you suppose they're going to do in the chambers? Right? Very explicit. Okay? Chapter 2, verse 7. Young women of Jerusalem, I charge you by the gazelles and the wild does of the field. Do not stir up or awaken love until the appropriate time. Again, the same thing. That phrase, awaken love, do not bother lovemaking in the field until the appropriate time. Okay, so scholars believe that you can translate that again to the physical act of having sex. Verse 10 through 13, my beloved speaks and says to me, arise, my love, my beautiful one, and come away. For behold, the winter is past, the rain is over and gone. The flowers appear on the earth, the time of singing has come, and the voice of the turtle dove is heard in our land. The fig tree ripens its figs, and the vines are in blossom. They give forth fragrance. Arise, my love, my beautiful one, and come away. Now again, scholars believe, as we read this, it looks like he's talking about the seasonal changes. Wouldn't you agree? So he's talking about the beauty of the seasons changing, which we can see. But when they talk about fruit, brothers and sisters, when they talk about fruit, like a tree ripens its figs, it's usually referred to genitals. I'm just throwing it out there, okay? The genitals of a man or a woman. And the vines are in blossom, they give forth fragrance. Arise, my love, my beautiful one, and come away. So the reader seems to be more concerned at the sexual awakening of his lover. Okay, and that's what the scholars believe. Okay, so as you read this passage, take a look at it from that perspective. Okay? Intimacy is a good thing designed by God. Intimacy is a good thing designed by God. Intimacy is at the core of our human existence. Intimacy is a celebration of love. Intimacy is an experience that forges a bond. And I thought about this. You know, intimacy is an experience that forges a bond. And that's why, you know, going back to my military background, you know, we're pretty... I've never been deployed. I mean, I take that back. I have been deployed, but I haven't been deployed to a war zone. Okay? It's just I wasn't called up. But, you know, we can certainly understand, you know, for those of us that serve in the military or have served in the military, that we kind of develop this bond, this closeness with the guys that we're with. So when I was, you know, 3 months in South Carolina, you know, we went through a lot of different things, a lot of the different training, and of course they would yell at us, and we would go back to our dorms and we would have, you know, different talks to try and encourage one another and all these kinds of things. But, you know, when we do military training like that, it's designed to break you, okay? And it's designed to build you up and to make you come back stronger. And so as we kind of take a look at that, that parallel, right, in marriages, right, as we go on, and of course, you know, Teresa and I, we just celebrated our 20th anniversary on the 4th of May. Thank you, everyone. And of course, it's been, you know, rocky. It's been up and down. It hasn't been smooth at all. But it's those times where we can share with one another because of the things that we went through together, because of the stressful times, because of the times that we've argued and fought, and the times that we've celebrated and come together again and made up and all these different things, we forged a bond. Okay, so that's what intimacy is about, right? Forging that bond. It's kind of like when you kind of rub together as iron sharpens iron, right? In Proverbs, it says, as iron sharpens iron, so man sharpens his fellow man. Amen? Intimacy is an act that impacts more than one's physical self. We talked about that, okay? It is an act that impacts more than one's physical self. So again, intimacy begins before the actual physical act, and it continues on after that. It is mutual self-giving. Mutual self-giving. Unlike Marvin Gaye, right, when he talked about sexual healing, it's good for me. Good for me. Then I thought to myself, well, what about your girlfriend? Or what about your wife? You know, I don't know. You know, it's mutual self-giving where it's designed to give pleasure to both parties. Amen. And it has to be consensual. Okay, we won't get into that. But it has to be agreed upon. It has to be consensual. Mutual self-giving. Giving each other pleasure. Okay? It is an invitation to be used of and to create with our Heavenly Father. In other words, procreation, right? Being intimate leads to sex, usually, and in this case, in this context, okay? And of course, procreation is how we have babies. The Apostle Paul wrote, Church of Galatians, he says, so I tell you, live by following the Spirit. Then you will not do what your sinful selves want. Our sinful selves want what is against the Spirit, and the Spirit wants what is against our sinful selves. The two are against each other, so you cannot do just what you please. Amen. So that phrase, sinful selves, really points to our desires. You can write in your notes there. Oh, I'm sorry, not yet. Actually, you can write in your notes. Number one, identify your appetites. Identify your appetites, and you can write in appetite equals desire. Okay. Identify your appetites, your sinful nature. Now, I wanted to read this, and let me find this. You can also write in your notes. Every soul desires intimacy, but every soul desires God. Sinful nature desires perversion. Every soul desires intimacy. Every soul desires God. Sinful nature desires perversion. So have you ever asked yourself, in your own life, in your own personal life, what are your burning desires? What are your burning desires? You know, for some of us, it's Long Johns from Zippy's. Some of us, it's, I don't know, burgers at Big City Diner at the counter. Some of us, it's poke. Some of us are a sucker for poke. All right, but what's your burning desire, okay? But I wanted to talk about perversion because, you know, we hear that word around sometimes. Perversion, or, you know, that's where we get the word pervert, okay? We're being explicit. Perversion means the alteration of something from its original course. meaning or state to a distortion or corruption of what was first intended. Okay? It is the alteration of something from its original course. If you guys don't want to write that down. The alteration of something from its original course. Of course, we talked about that, right? How sex is perverted. And, you know, going back again, I don't want to be repeating myself, but we look on the internet, we look at the different shows that are on in the media, you know, so on and so forth. Bruce Jenner, you know, you guys can go look at that, you know, all these different things. It's just been warped. It's been twisted. Pervert. Sexual behavior or desire that is considered abnormal or unacceptable. Sexual behavior or desire that is considered abnormal or unacceptable. Okay. Now, brothers and sisters, you know, this whole time I was thinking that today was going to be family day. And I forgot that we had moved family day because of the graduation weekend. So I was thinking to myself, how am I going to, you know, do a rated R message with PG rating? Right? But the idea is this. The whole idea is when, as a pastoral staff, and we came together and we wanted to talk about the explicit series in our families, simply because we want to be able to create an environment where kids and parents are comfortable with one another to have conversations. Can I get an amen? Because again, like I said, if you don't influence your children, the media will. And whatever, and like I said last week, if you don't stand up for something, you're going to fall for anything. Amen. And so as parents, we have to take a stand. And so, you know, Teresa is going to be talking about inoculating our children. Okay, and I want to get into that. But simply because we have to not hide the fact that it's there. Okay, we have to acknowledge that it is there. And if we don't help shape the way they think, or we don't help to steer them, the world will. And of course, if we don't help them to, you know, point true north, they will always go south quickly, if you know what I mean. Amen. Okay? Proverbs 5, 15 and 19 says, drink water from your own well, guys. Share your lovemaking only with your wife. Why spill the water of your springs in the streets, having sex with just anyone? Very explicit, right? And the Lord stopped me there. Because in the New Testament, when Jesus talks about the wellspring of life, right? He is the living waters. So it's kind of like an allusion to Jesus being the wellspring of life. And when we're engaging in illicit sex, right? We're basically taking away our life source. Do you see that? And we're slowly killing ourselves. Verse 16, why spill the water, the life spring, in the streets, having sex with just anyone? You should reserve it for yourselves. Never share it with strangers. Let your wife be a fountain of blessing for you. Rejoice in the wife of your youth. She is a loving deer, a graceful doe. Let her breasts satisfy you always. May you always be captivated by her love. And Teresa's breasts satisfy me. Amen. I don't mean it that way. I was just waiting to see if you guys are awake. Okay. I don't mean it that way, but you know, okay, it says. Hallelujah. May you always be captivated by your love. Okay. Number two, that's explicit. Number two, control your appetites. We all have appetites. We all have desires. Turn to your neighbor and say, control it. Right? If you can't control it, find somebody. Okay? Find an accountability partner to help you control it. We all have appetites. We all have desires. Okay? And this is an example right here. That, you know, this female is biting into her burger, but what's going on in her brain? Right? All the neurotransmitters in her brain is just firing crazy now. And I wanted to read this. Okay, where is that? Okay. It says, God is so amazing, He creates everything for a purpose, even our desires, okay? So in your brain, there is what is called accumbens nucleus, okay? The accumbens nucleus is otherwise known as the motivation, pleasure, reward, and learning center that includes compulsion and preservation. It produces a bunch of neurotransmitters, right? That's the one that's firing, right? All the electricity going on in your brain. The main one being dopamine. Okay, dopamine. That's the feel-good chemicals that happen in your brain, right? Dopamine is what tells the body there is pleasure. It allows us to fix on the reward and motivates us to act on it. So you keep getting these dopamine hits, and what happens is after a while, your body becomes desensitized so that the next time around, you need more and more. This is why pornography often doesn't remain on the screen because you can only get so much stimuli out of it. Eventually, you will feel the need to act out what you see. Normal stimuli will no longer satisfy. That might be the reason for study results noting greater impotence, okay, among men who partake in pornography. Why? Because they can't get stimulated anymore. Now, funny thing is, you know, a couple of weeks ago we had chaplain training out in Kaneohe, and one of the chaplains got up and he talked about, because he's a full-time minister as well, and he talked about doing a study. He did a personal study on his own. All these soldiers that would come back from the war zone, and because they're in a heightened state of alert, you know, when they're downrange, because all the bullets are flying, all the bombs are going off, they just have this adrenaline just in their body all the time, right? So when they come home, right, or they experience, actually, you know, when they're downrange, they experience highs and lows, right, because of their adrenaline. So they find ways to keep themselves stimulated. So a lot of the guys, you know, they unfortunately get into pornography because of the internet and all these kinds of things. So when they come back home and all the adrenaline is down and they need to decompress and all these kinds of things, they're not intimate with their wives anymore. It's hard for them to readjust back into civilian life because they experience, you know, PTSD and all these kinds of things. And they have to learn how to be intimate with their wives again. And so because of what pornography does to them. And so they look at their wife, they're not stimulated enough because they're more stimulated by what they see on the screen. So he said that it takes for them about 6 to 8 weeks for them to reprogram their computer, because your brain is like a computer. And just like that picture that I show, the electro stimuli, the neurotransmitters, it familiarizes itself with a certain circuitry, a certain path that the circuit takes. So the 6 to 8 weeks, when they come back home, they have to reprogram their computer, basically. Reprogram in a sense that they have to learn how to become intimate with their wives again. You see that? So those are the kinds of things that addictions will do to someone. And it's not just pornography, it's food as well. It could be working out, it could be different things, it could be, you know, watching different certain types of TV shows or movies or what have you. It's different things, okay? Control it. Control your appetites. James 5:16. Reminds us to confess our sins to one another and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The earnest prayer of a righteous person, man or woman, has great power and produces wonderful results. Okay? Number three, know where your appetite will lead you. Braden, can I get you up here? Know where your appetites will lead you. Braden, can I get you up here? Know where your appetites will lead you. What do I mean by that? Flee the evil desires of youth and pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace, along with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. Everybody say pure heart. Okay, now I know that our hearts can only be cleansed by the power of Jesus Christ. Okay, and so I want to pray that this morning. But as we do this, I want to share some statistics. And this is pretty amazing. Some interesting statistics. Infidelity, right? Infidelity is what? Having sex outside of the marriage. Infidelity rates between men and women are near 50-50. Okay, so it's not just men, it's not just women, it's both, unfortunately. Infidelity rates between men and women are near 50-50. The national averages show by the time youth are seniors in high school, nearly 64% have had intercourse. Okay? 25% of women who have partaken in binge drinking are victims of unwanted contact or rape. 25%. The more alcohol, the more likely they would be victimized. This one was shocking. 50% of all Christian men and 20% of all Christian women, notice I say Christian men and Christian women, are addicted to porn. Okay? Why do you think that is, brothers and sisters? We won't get into that. I do have a few theories of my own, but fascinating. 50% of all Christian men and 20% of all Christian women are addicted to porn. 93% of boys and 62% of girls are exposed to porn before their 18th birthday. Hallelujah. When I was in college, mind you, I went to a private Catholic college. Right? So I thought I would be safe from that kind of stuff. On the contrary, right? I remember one of my roommates, he was one of my roommates, and he had a library. You guys know what I'm talking about? He had a library. Okay, if you know what I'm talking about. Every weekend, he would lay it out under his bed. Right? And I would see these things because I would be on my bed and I would be playing my guitar. And I was like, what is that? And I look under his bed and he had a whole library just laid out. And I was like, oh, okay, so, whatever. We're in San Francisco, right? Just kind of roll with it, right? But, it got bad where he started partying. And then, on the weekends, he would invite guys coming in and they would all drink and do all this kind of stuff. And they would all browse through his library, if you will. And I thought, this just doesn't feel right. This just doesn't feel good. And so that's when, and Teresa's kind of laughing at me because, I called home and said, hey, Mom, can I get my own room? I don't want to be sharing a room with anybody because we're supposed to be in a private Catholic college. Why do we have people like this in here, and all this kind of stuff. But that was how it was back then. And so I've had to repent of a lot of things myself. I've had to confess a lot of things to the Lord. I remember another time is I needed an elective, and this is all in college, private Catholic college. I needed an elective, and I said, okay, well, I'm going to just pick something easy, something simple. And I picked an art class, art. Right, because I like to sketch, I like to draw things. So it'll be easy, no big deal. So I get into the class, and then the teacher announces, "Hey, we're going to be having nudes come in, and they're going to be modeling for you, and then you're going to be drawing them." Okay, so I'll be walking around, and you just draw the nudes. We're in San Francisco, so I'm like, okay, no big deal, just roll with it, right? So I'm thinking to myself, okay, this is pretty cool. This is a neat experience, and genuinely, brothers and sisters, genuinely, I was there enjoying. Now I want to say this carefully, okay, because I sincerely mean this. I was there enjoying the beauty of the human body. Okay? I was truly enjoying the beauty of the human body. So, you know, females would come in and they would pose and we would draw, and then the guys would come in and they would draw and all this kind of stuff. And so, you know, it was no big deal to me. And I remember this one time, one of the male models came in and he posed, right? And he couldn't control himself, if you know what I mean. Completely nude, completely naked. He couldn't control himself. And so the teacher goes, it was just like this older Korean lady. She was like a Korean art professor. Oh, you know, if you can't control yourself, I'm going to have to ask you to leave. You know, and the guy was just there and he was all, right? He couldn't control himself. So I'm thinking to myself, ha, 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 you know, we're in San Francisco, just roll with it. But I thought to myself, I said, hey, you know what? You know, people are a lot more open and free about their sexuality than some. There's some people who are a little bit more modest. But in reality, when I was thinking, you know, was there anything wrong with that experience? I don't, you're going to have to make that, you know, decision for yourself. But personally for me, I was sincerely enjoying God's creation. Even back then, I had that understanding. Even back then, I had that appreciation for what was actually going on. Because that was what our art professor was communicating to us. It wasn't anything perverse. It wasn't anything perverted. It wasn't anything warped or anything like that. Now, I don't know about that one guy that couldn't control himself, who got up in front of everybody and, you know, was the model. I don't know about that guy, but he was kind of a creep in my opinion. But experiences, you know, those kinds of experiences in life, it's all around us. Like I said, it's in the media. It penetrates our culture. It's well within in our children's culture. And if we don't stand up, brothers and sisters, and help our children navigate through these things, they're going to go woo-woo in the head and think that everything is okay. Meaning that everything God approves of. And in reality, God doesn't approve of everything that you see, hear about in the media. Amen? And so we have to go back to the Word of God and find out exactly how God designed and what He means for us to understand or perceive and look at sex properly. Amen? So as we close, brothers and sisters, I want to pray. I want to pray that as we cry out to the Lord to have a pure heart. Amen? And then I'm going to have Braden sing a song, and I want to invite you to sing with us the song. Okay, so if you could all bow your heads. Father God, we come before you this morning, and we know sometimes, Heavenly Father, as we talk about this subject, you know, it can make people uncomfortable. But Lord God, we break all that. Amen? Because we don't want to define sex by the world's standards. We want to define sex by your holy standard, Lord God. And so we come before you, you know, confessing all of our sins, confessing all of our thoughts, as the Apostle Paul reminds us, Lord. Heavenly Father, come clean us. As David wrote in Psalm 51, make in me a clean heart and renew my spirit. Renew a steadfast spirit within me, Lord. As we stand before you, purified, so that we can give you all the glory in our lives. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. And all in agreement say, amen. Okay, so we're going to sing this song.
Finest linen, holy and purity, my Lord.
Verse just one again. Can we sing that again?
Let everything that isn't pure in your sight, Lord Jesus, be swept away by your power, Lord. I want to stand before you, dressed in the finest linen, holy in purity, my Lord. Pure and holy, giving glory to the King of Kings. Here before you, I adore you. Praises I will bring. I set my eyes upon you. I focus my mind on you. I want to give you all so much. Touch me and move my spirit. Love me without a limit. Oh Lord, I cry out for your touch.
Sing that again, verse 2.
I set my eyes upon you. I focus my mind on you. I want to give you all so much. Touch me and move my spirit. Love me without a limit. Oh Lord, I cry out for your touch. Pure and holy, giving glory to the King of Kings. Here before you, I adore you.
So funny. Like I said, you know, I was supposed to have military duties this week, and then I was, you know, rescheduled, so I was going to be here.
It's because then, I love Lord too. He loves me more than he loves you.
See, but then I just had this thought, you know, that Pastor Teresa was all like, okay, since you're going to be here, then you give the message, right? And you know, I didn't want to speak for her, but, you know, maybe she was feeling a little uncomfortable about the topic or whatever. But then the Lord told me, no, Glenn, you just have more garbage than she does. You know, so you share. You share all your garbage. I said, okay. You know, but I know that Pastor Teresa has a lot on her heart, you know, regarding this subject. And as we were singing that song, brothers and sisters, I just felt like maybe there's some of us here that feels a little condemnation. And I just want to say, give it all to Jesus and don't feel the condemnation anymore. Amen. Because we all have stuff.
Amen.
And we have Jesus that we can just, Jesus, take it from me. Give it all to him. And I wanted Pastor Teresa to pray along those lines.
So he asked me earlier, are you going to want to share? I'm like, nah, I'm good. You can talk about it. And obviously sex is not my favorite topic. You know, he cherishes that act of lovemaking more than I do, but I serve my husband in that. And it was funny because when I found out I was pregnant, Braden, he's so cute. Our kids are so innocent, so pure. And I pray that that would continue in them. That I don't know what we did to kind of help protect them from the evils of the world, but, you know, and they have been exposed to the evils of the world, but he so innocently said, when did that happen? And for those of you that are parents here and there are teenagers, you have teenagers, you know what I'm talking about. You get very creative, right? But I honestly, it's been a journey for me. When I was in high school, I went to a Catholic youth thing. And I remember the youth leader, when it was late at night, put on pornography for everybody. And that was my first exposure to pornography. And let me tell you, at that young age, I was appalled and I was devastated. And I remember being scarred. I literally had to...
The youth leader?
Yeah. I literally had to take that one to Jesus. And, you know, the good thing is I never engaged in that in sexual intercourse before while I was in high school. It wasn't going to happen. I was so devastated by what I saw. I was like, oh, guys were evil in my mind after what I saw. But it really has been a work of God's grace in me to redeem that which the enemy tried to rob. That sex is supposed to be something beautiful between a husband and a wife to create life. And I look at my children and I'm like, I would never not want to participate in the beauty of what that is to have the beautiful children that we have. Can I get an amen? And I have to thank my husband because my husband has been very gracious. He's been very patient. He's been very loving in my process to really embrace fully that sex is a good and a God thing. Because like I said, I had some negativity about it because I see women get objectified. And he knows. He previews movies for me. He's like, that's not one you want to watch, honey. Don't go watch that one. Because if I watch a movie and there is objectification of women especially, I'm telling you, the prophet in me wants to like take on the world. That the voice in me of the Lord wants to speak out against it violently. Because I don't want young girls growing up like that. I want them to have some self-respect, some dignity. You know, we go through the town and you see these young women and the way they dress, I don't know that they realize that they're allowing for themselves to get objectified. You know, so we can't just blame the guys. Us women need to take ownership of our bodies and present them in a modest way to not cause the brothers around us to stumble and to fall, and vice versa. So my heart in what I want to share is that it doesn't matter what you've been exposed to. You know, maybe you're sitting here and you're like, oh, I've seen pornography. Well, you know what? That's okay. Praise God for the grace of the Lord who can clean us from the inside out. Can I get an amen? Maybe you're here and you've engaged in premarital sex and you maybe you have a sex addiction. Believe it or not, that is an addiction. Men or women that have to have it. Like they can't not have it. You know what? It's an addiction. We just want to encourage you as the body of Christ that wherever you are, whatever you're struggling with, or whatever perversion is in your mind that you don't even realize is there, the Lord can redeem it. And it first starts with, as in James, you need to confess that to somebody. Confess it to somebody, and then you receive healing. It's not you receive healing. You got to confess it first. You know, and I'm glad that Pastor Glenn shared that, you know, your appetite is not just about sex. It could be alcohol. It could be whatever it is. But the bottom line is, it's supposed to be a pure thing. All of these good things that God creates for his people, for our enjoyment and for our pleasure, it's supposed to be a pure thing. And we want to offer ourselves before the Lord knowing that we are pure. Do we purify ourselves? No. The Lord does that work. The Lord purifies us. The Lord renews our mind. And so I agree that we can't be uncomfortable talking about this subject. Because if we're uncomfortable talking about it, then guess what? Our kids are going to go seek it out somewhere else. They're going to go to school and ask, well, you know, what do you think? And we don't want that happening because I'm here to tell you, in schools today, everything goes. Since they legalized gay marriages in the state of Hawaii, everything goes. Cross-gender, transgender, whatever you can think of, it has to go. And what we are contending for is the biblical understanding of what sex was in the image that God created it to be and for its purpose. It was for intimacy. It was for intimacy and it was for creating life, right? And I pray that as you reflect deeply on your intimacy with your spouse, if there is anything that is amiss there, take that before the Lord and he'll bring healing there. And more importantly, as you reflect on your intimacy with your spouse, that is the same kind of intimacy that the Lord wants to have with you. When people ask me, Pastor Teresa, what does your intimate walk with the Lord look like? It's like sex. Intimacy. There's nothing that is left unexposed to the Lord. He sees it all. And if we look into the eyes of our Father, he'll let us see all of him too. And that's the intimacy we're looking for, not only with our relationship with the Lord, but with our spouse. And the last thing I want to share is, you can avoid perversion in your life when you think of others as more important than yourself. If you see every other human being more importantly than yourself, you will not objectify them. You will not take advantage of them, and you will not look at them as a commodity for which they can just satisfy your pleasure. Instead, you are going to look at, how can I serve this person? When you're making love to your spouse, how can I serve this person? I can tell you many a time, explicit, Glenn and I are letting you in, okay? And my kids are probably a little uncomfortable. That's okay. There are many a times where I was exhausted. You know, Glenn wants to get intimate. He's like, I miss you. We don't talk anymore. And I'm exhausted. And he's like, we don't have to be intimate. It's okay, Teresa. And I'm like, no. I'm okay, honey. I'm okay. I love you and I want to serve you in this. I'm okay. And I'll just say, you don't have to just make it long. Maybe not long, you know. But he honors me in that and I honor him in that, right? Praise Jesus. Brayden's like, just preparing you, honey, for when you get married. Just preparing you. He's blushing back there. Hey, we're just keeping it real, people. We're keeping it real. I mean, you want to know how you talk to your kids? This is how you do it. We don't hide stuff. I mean, we're not letting them in the room. You know what I mean? We're not, like, letting them watch and stuff. But you got to talk about it. I remember when Brayden first had his girlfriend. I'm going to call her your girlfriend. Officially, I'm calling her the girlfriend. They've never kissed. They've never, you know. And when we had a discussion about it, I talked to him about that. He's like, Mom, why can't I kiss her? And I just said, honey, I want you to think of it like this.
Why do you say that?
I want you to think of it like this. I want you to imagine on your day you get married to her. And she's standing before you and you're getting ready to take her, the two become one, into me see. And I want you to imagine every single guy that she might have kissed before you. How do you feel? He's like, well, that's gross. I said, exactly. So honor her. If she's not the one, you don't want the guy that is going to marry her to have to know that you were kissing on her because she belongs to him. He's like, well, when you say it like that, that makes sense. That's what I'm trying to say. And now some people may think that's legalistic. We're not telling you what you need to do or how you need to live. What I'm saying is there is a pureness that the Lord wants for his people when it comes to sex. And it only takes one to take a stand, and then somebody else will take a stand, and then another will take a stand. But if the body of Christ will get past being uncomfortable with this topic and start teaching the generations on how to live righteous before God in a pure and holy way and cherish that which was supposed to be a blessing, we can dispel perversion with the next generation. Our generation, a little bit too late. But the next generation can make it right. And the generation before them can even make it better, right? Okay, and that's what we're talking about. That's why we wanted to talk about sex. Because we're trying to redeem everything for the Lord. The Lord wants to redeem everything. He came to redeem everything. Not just to redeem you, but every aspect of who you are. And sexuality is a part of who we are. Amen? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, with every eye closed and with every head bowed, if there are people here that are feeling condemnation, Father, I come against it in the name of Jesus. And Father, we declare that there is no condemnation in Christ. There is only great conviction in you. And so, Father, I pray with every eye closed and every head bowed all across the room, Father God, that whatever is going on in the hearts of your people, you know what's going on in their hearts. You know what's going on in their minds. Father God, that you would speak to it by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you would convict them of the areas that they need to change, that they would truly look to you to understand greater what intimacy is, so that when they encounter their spouse, they truly know how to be intimate with that person. Father, we pray that you would redeem everything that the enemy tried to rob from your people. Father, make sex a pure and a holy thing, a beautiful thing. Like Pastor Glenn said, the human body is a beautiful creation. And I pray, Father God, that we would not see it with eyes of perversion, but that you would transform our eyes, that you would transform our mind, that you would transform our hearts so that we can see these things as you see them. Father, we say begin in us and allow for us to raise up the next generations in holiness and in purity for your greater glory, O Lord. And it's in your son's name we pray all these things, and all of God's children said, amen and amen and amen. Would you give the Lord a hand clap for what he's done? I want to encourage you that if you still have questions, take that communication card, write out your question. Pastor Glenn and myself may not have the answer, but we surely will go find it for you. But we want to make sure that this is a congregation, this is a church, Ohana, this is a family where we wrestle with the truth and the hard stuff together, amen? We want to wrestle together. We don't want to wrestle alone. The enemy wants you to wrestle alone. Why? Because he can defeat you when you're alone. But when we wrestle together, he cannot come against this. There's no place to hide when we create an environment that allows for people to be transparent and authentic and genuine and truthful. When we live like that, then the light of Christ shines brightly and he redeems everything that the enemy would try and rob for us. Amen. I think they're going to sing a closing song, yeah? Maybe we should sing a happy song. Kind of loosen us up a little bit. What are we supposed to sing, honey?
All That We Are.
We'll sing All That We Are. Would you stand to your feet as we sing the happy song?
Cross, gave it all for us so that we might know.